So this is what's going to happen. Four of the artists are going to present 15-minute presentations, and then at the very end, they're going to have their in conversations, and I will mention how, and they'll come and sit here and have those in conversations for about 20 to 30 minutes.
My name is Akiko. It's good to see Leon's talk first. It's coincident. I feel like a pigeon, and like a lady on that sleeping on that ground. Yeah. Oh, okay. Can you put it down? Okay. Yes. Yeah, I thought that the first talk really, it's coincident. It's good to hear that someone's talking about pigeons and insomnia, because I can relate to that. So, first of all, when I think of my photographs, I feel like a stranger for my own work. This sensation really resonates to my own relationship with my own body, too. Since I was a child, I felt like I have already lived my life once, and kind of watching outside, like as outsider, observer watching my life being replayed once more time. I have often wondered how deaf people are observing us. This curiosity probably stems from my first encounter with death. When I was 7, my aunt passed away, and knowing that she was about to die, my aunt told me that she would have less regret to leave this world if she knew that she could still send a letter from the heaven. I feel that my captures on my, all the images I capture on my films are, in fact, the views of the dead people, and not so much my own views or thoughts. Of course, I'm pleased when people give me compliments, and if I, my work gets complimented. But I feel that I still don't own these images, and a question lies in my head that, can I actually claim these photos to be my own work of art? It is often the case that the most successful shots are the ones I don't remember how or when I shot it. The Headland series are an example of this, as well as Najima, the series it was shot when my grandparents' house was just going to be demolished. It was under the naked light, and my grandfather passed away, and under the cold winter light filtered through the bamboo groves, my aunt passed away too. So I feel these lights at the house were the witness of their death, and in turn, what marks my films. Japanese culture is based on the wide acceptance of continuum between life and death. This is still the case in the today's Japan. These series, the Osorezan and Goshogawara, were taken in Aomori prefectures, located in the very north of Japan. Both mountains are steeped into the belief that human spirits go up into the mountain when they die. They both have a Buddhist temple, well known for calming the souls of dead children. The area's harsh environment and the poverty meant that children often died young, or mothers had to abort their children. Well, I mean, abort their babies. In Goshogawa-gara, there's a shrine called Bridal Shrine. Most of the dead belonging to the shrine, they died young, so they were not able to marry. So God will wed them once they leave. Their parents order those of bride and groom to be made, and even give the name and the wedding date. After a few years, the couple assume to have a children, so that parents bring baby dolls to represent this. After I visited several times, I feel very heavy weight of the place. I think it's a kind of the breeze with a great will still is still living more than that of the dead one. As ones left behind as well, we often can't let go to the deceased and set them free. Modern Japanese society is repressed and damaged in many ways. I feel that this is partly connected to the quality of hush white fluorescence lights that are widely used in the country. Some time ago, Japanese girl who had just moved to London told me that her 19 years old grandmother walked into the sea at night and committed suicide. Every time she thinks of her grandmother's death, she feels the urge Japanese fluorescence lights. She dim European lights are not strong enough to wipe out my fear of my grandmom's death. It has to be the harsh white artificial light. So since then, the image of the old lady entering the sea at night and the girl alone in the brightly lit room in the city flickered in my head. So the story made me think that quality of light have ability to erase the fear of death and blind us from facing it. Perhaps the artificial lights with more other modern technologies are our unconscious way to trying to escape this fear. So yes, this saying was said by Serge Tisserand. And my ongoing photograph series entitled Where We Belong is probably a reaction towards my encounter with some peculiar images of a boy being tortured in the snow by his parents, shown on the Japanese documentary TV program. And after heavy snowfall, a Japanese couple took their child deep into the forest and ordered him to lie still on the icy ground. They then proceed to pack snow over his naked body. The couple photograph every stage of the cruel activity leading to eventual death. And in the photo, one of the parents appear next to him too, and using their car headlights. And a voiceover commented that the couple said, and he also think, that actually social worker say, that the punishment was a way of showing their love. So I feel that every image in the series of Where We Belong captures that the last moment of something, the last gasp of darkness, the last quiver of light, the blessed objects and people resigned to their own fate. Is life just a small signal drifting amongst the wild white noise, a flickering light, a brown petal from a night cherry blossom that appears and disappears the next moment? So I'd like to talk about some thoughts I'm inspired by the short story called Caterpillar by Edogawa Rampo, a Japanese writer. Rampo's stories, The Caterpillar, is about seemingly humble, faithful wife caring for her husband who has been horribly deformed by injuries sustained during the war. The title comes from the appearance of him after has had all of her limbs amputated and most features of his face destroyed. Often he would lie on his grave belly and using these amputated stumps to propel himself, managed to spin and run around a top made of living flesh. Beneath people's praise of the wife's devotion, she thinks that she can hear her sarcastic inner voice accusing her of a living lie. The wife feels this guilt because, although Howard timid her, she had always entertained a strange liking of bullying the weak. Moreover, watching the agony of this poor cripple allows many of her hidden imposes. The only one of five senses remained to the husband is his sight. The wife starts to see these shining eyes as the imperfection on the lump of flesh that her husband has become. So one night, when she sees him wake and a thoughtful staring at the ceiling with his bright eyes, she goes into a frenzy, hitting her husband and finally poking his eyes out with her fingers, leaving her husband, caterpillar, spinning around on the floor with blood spraying from his eye sockets. This is the only story by Lampo that was refused publication by authorities at that time, Japanese authorities, supposedly because it was perceived as being anti-war and because of its unsettling eroticism. However, concealed behind these official reasons, I feel that there was a greater fear of work, the question, prevailing ideas of morality, and what is and what isn't beautiful. What I found beautiful, this story, is its ending, where the sightless caterpillar somehow escaped from her house searching for him. His wife hears a faint rustling sound, and in the dim light, a black thing was wriggling sluggishly in the thick growth of weeds. Seeing this left, her transfixed with fear, and a few seconds later, she heard a faint sound of a splash of Venus, the ground in the wheat, ground in what seemed like a bowl of the earth. It turns out that that caterpillar has fallen into the well. To me, the moment when the caterpillar makes faint splash into the bottom of the well forms the split second when the world is transformed into the dark, fluid eternity, capable of sucking the stars out of the sky. The reason why I found this beautiful is that something which is almost a symbol of grotesqueness contains a wisdom beyond the ethical or normal, reversing the world's gravity while bringing all this element of dark and night together into wholeness. So I often feel that my mind and body are separated, united only a feeling of exhaustion. The time when I overcome this separation are when I encounter with image that gives me physical and spiritual joy. Those images are often what people find negative or depressing. So my photographs have predominantly have shot in the hours of darkness into the deep end of the night. The sensation of the nighttime are a very important element for me to confront. I think this is connected to my lifelong insomnia, the sleeping problem, a behavior I believe to be caused by the sexual abuse I experienced growing up. I now see it as a lifelong task to embrace the uncomfortable bodily memory embedded within me through image making, rather than trying to erase them altogether. Since 2014, I have had a breast cancer twice, so I went through a few treatments and operations. Through this, I had to face the association my breasts have had in the past. I was always conscious my breasts didn't belong to my own body. As a child, I was always terribly conscious of them growing very fast, a feeling I believe that was caused by countless nights of abuse. Along with the cancer, several elements come together in my life recently, leading to a transition in my work. I began to receive NHS therapy for sexual abuse trauma during my recovery from my second cancer. The group I was referred to consisted of three Jamaican ladies, and one of the therapists was also Jamaican ladies. It was an intensive series of 40 sessions. Each person sharing their experience of abuse and how it had impacted in their life. They offered in their family history to their grandparents' generation and the difficulties caused by racial issues in the society at that time and now. Also around, it continued to affect their children's lives as well. So from this experience, I have become interested in Black people's history and wanted to learn about ancient history of Africa in order to better understand the world current issues. I also felt that the origin of Japanese people are also related to this shared history. So during my therapy, I became involved with the Black People's Communities events, particularly with an organization called Black History Study. I started to attend numerous activities, including documentary film screenings, at which I was fascinated to see by different generations, from young to old, they are communicating with each other before and after the events. I have also been traveling together with the people from this community, visiting other cities such as Amsterdam, to be guided by the local Black history specialist, learning the hidden history of the world from actual Black people's perspective. I think what I've been touched about being with community people has been, although sometimes happen to you, I'm the only non-Black person, I'm a different racial background, but they kind of welcome me, and like NHS group therapy people, the Jamaican ladies, they accepted me for how I am, which has been a nice feeling. And so I began to take all these photos of those eventually, and initially not so much as my project, but because I just wanted to capture the moments and the company I was enjoying. And this way of photographing is different from my previous practice, which was mostly done in the isolation. Thank you.
Thank you, Akiko. We next have Grace Gelder.
Okay, can everybody hear me all right? Yeah. I have a little bit of a funny throat, so hopefully I won't do a Theresa May and cough all the way through my talk, but I'll do my best. So I wanted to start with a series that I shot in Mongolia, which was part of my MA. And I studied for a year through an English university, but it was based in China. And for our final project, we had to travel to another part of China or another country to do a book project. And I decided to go to Mongolia. And I did quite a lot of research before the trip, and I made contact with an organization that were called the Gender Center for Sustainable Development. And And I went along and found some of the areas on the outskirts of Ulaanbaatar, which is the capital city, with some social workers. And I did various shoots, and I looked at them after a month. And the most interesting photographs that I had were when I met official people in the offices. And I didn't realize until I was there that 66% of the professional workforce of Mongolia are female. And not many people knew about it. And before I went, all of the images that I'd seen of Mongolia were the rural population. So there would be the ger, the house, and the sheep, and everybody with their designated roles. And it was a Skype with my grandmother that I had whilst I was there, where I said to her, oh, it's amazing, there's all these women doing really incredible jobs around the city. And she said, oh, I didn't even know there was a university in Mongolia. So it was very, it was a really interesting thing to encounter. And I met women in all walks of professional careers and put the series together as a book. And I think this particular image was the one where I realized how collaborative this way of working was for me, because this woman is the director of the women's prison, and she gave me quite a grilling before I did the shoot. And once she'd given me the okay, she went into the room at the back and disappeared for a short while, and she reemerged with this fantastic magenta lipstick and her hat. And then she spent quite a long time arranging all the objects on the desk, and she's just completely taken over. And I think that really set the precedent of how I've worked ever since, in terms of the how I share the process of creating the images and the relationship that I want the people that I photograph to have with me, and the level of autonomy that I want them to have too. Okay, so that, in this is a recent series I did along that same thread, where I asked people to tell me what it was that they were hoping for, a bit like a New Year's resolution. And I asked them to bring an object to the shoot that would communicate that. It didn't have to be very obvious. It could be quite symbolic. It could be quite private. And this woman is a theatre maker, and she was doing a solo one-woman show about depression. And so she was hoping for a lot of success with her show in a year. So she brought along a gold lamé cat suit and a sparkly golden jacket. And so we made a series of images, and this was the one that she chose and became part of her theatre performance as well. So the use of objects is something that I've gone back to again and again as a way of bringing that person's thoughts and ideas into the shoot. And this was a residency that I did last March in Sweden. And it was in South Sápmi, which is the Sami word for Lapland. And it was part of a conference for the Nordic Summer University. And then this was a residency for 2 weeks that four of us stayed on to do afterwards. And it was a really interesting residency for me, because I was told that the population is very small, and that my proposal was to do similar work with objects. So I'd started a project looking at people's ancestral heritage, and I was asking people to bring an object that connected somehow to an ancestor. Again, it could be symbolic or it could be very literal. And there were four of us on the residency, all from different disciplines. And we found out later that they'd specifically chosen us because they imagined there'd be lots of crossover of working styles and lots of potential to collaborate. And so I spent a lot of time with my fellow residency mates talking about the snow and what was under the snow. And that particular region seemed to have a lot of secrets, and there was lots of there was a lot of mystery in the house that we were staying in, and there was a lot of very unpleasant histories, especially around the Sami people. And it was the first time that I felt like the camera in itself was incredibly loaded. Because the Sami people, of which there were some in the nearby area, but we were quite south. There's more Sami people the more north you go. but there was in the 20s in Sweden a place in the south called the Center for Racial Biology, and they had a particularly unpleasant eugenics program which is said to have inspired Hitler. And one of the ways that they practiced this program and documented and gathered evidence was to photograph the Sami people. And this is something that's been reclaimed by Sami photographers, and they've done some really interesting work. It was the first time for me as a photographer in a place with a camera where I realized that there was a lot of like, was a lot of discomfort there for me. And we talked a lot about this. And so Tuli was the, she was doing a performance art-based residency, and the two of us started to collaborate, and she wanted to do something which would connect her with the secrets that were underneath the snow. So we talked about that, and we did a, she did a very short performance for camera, partly because of logistical reasons, it was really cold. And she wanted to just get under the snow. And it was the first photography collaboration I've done where I had the hard task of actually burying her in the snow. So it was quite labour intensive as collaborations are. But yeah. And then this is the work that I'd originally proposed. And people from the community know that this was something that I wanted to do, and if anybody was interested, to contact me. And this man is called Joel. And his father was Sami. He identifies as Sami. And he was really keen to become part of the project. And again, he completely took over the shoot. Originally, we sat in the kitchen chatting, and I asked him where he would like to be photographed. And he immediately took me to the kota outside, which is a wooden structure that the Sami people live in. And he made a fire. We thought that it was we were ever going to be able to do while we were there, but he just, snow, it doesn't matter, cleaned the snow out, made a fire, sat there, and then started to talk for about an hour and a half. I have a very long interview with him talking about his heritage through this object, which has multiple purposes for him. He uses it to drink coffee out of, he uses it to move snow out the way, and he uses it to get water from the stream. So he was very keen to tell me about that because it had belonged to his great-grandfather. And this is somebody that I did the same in London. So this was a small diary that belonged to her great-great aunt. And she wanted to share that with me. And then it occurred to me that the projects that I've showed you already are all something where there's a lot more planning involved. And I know that this is the work that I want to do, and I'm a bit more influential in creating it. But when I saw the name of the symposium was Encountering Difference, I realized that it's this unexpected quality that I have had quite a lot. And a lot of the projects that have emerged for me have come from unexpected encounters with people. So this young lady, she wrote to me completely out of the blue, and she was a recovering anorexic, and she wanted to work with me and to do some photography to see if she could see herself differently. And we had a very long process of talking about the problematics of this and the potentials of this, and it's led to a 4-year long, we meet a few times a year, process, which has been very interesting because she's going through the transition of becoming predominantly a patient to becoming a doctor. And so I've been incorporating elements in our shoots where she has to take more, she has to take more of an incentive around what happens. I give her more choices, and we've been playing a lot between the interpersonal dynamics of photography, and then that she's reflected that that's helped her with her transition from patient to junior doctor. And we had an in-conversation about this project when the Tate Exchange opened. They had an event called The Give and the Take, and it was really nice to hear her speak publicly about that, this process as well. This lady I met on a bench, and we became friends, and she's a Marlene Dietrich impersonator. was very self-conscious about her age, but we had a lot of fun, and we would just go off in London for the day, and she would interact with walls. I think this is somewhere near Buckingham Palace, where she was getting quite into the royal vibes. And this young lady I also met on a bench not far from the one that I met Anchor on, actually, I've just realised. I was documenting an all-night run, and we'd stopped outside of a pub near Westbourne Grove, and it was midnight. And I saw this young lady on the bench, and she looked really upset. And there was a big bunch of us stopped there, and so I got chatting to her and asked her how she was doing and what was going on. Gave her some chocolate, and then she said she was locked out and she was a bit upset about it. And then she told me she was from Syria and she'd come here about 3 years ago, and she was studying to, I can't remember the name of the qualification, so she could do a degree here. And we met up soon after, and she said, oh, could you bring your camera? So I thought, yeah, sure. And it turned out that in Damascus she'd been quite a well-known poet and had done a lot of spoken word poetry events and had loads of really professional studio shoots done of her. She showed me some of them on her phone, and she was really missing that, and nobody had taken a picture of her since she'd been to the UK. I realised just how much she absolutely loves it. And so we met up a few times, and it just became a way for her to have a bit of a laugh and have some fun. And one day she said to me, I'd really like you to take some photos. Can you do tomorrow afternoon? And I said, well, I've got quite a lot on, but I can do maybe like an hour and a half of photography. And then she turned up in the image on the right. She came with this dress. She said, I've bought this dress. I was engaging and I was going to wear this for our engagement party, so I've brought it along for the photo shoot today. I was like, okay, that's quite important. So we did a whole shoot with her in her blue dress, which felt like a real occasion. And another aspect of my work is to do nude photo shoots. And I work with lots of different people, various thoughts about their body, or they want to see what happens if they take their clothes off. And quite often it's people who've just started doing some sort of performance. So they want to capture that part of them that's emerging. And I had one client who worked in a very sort of conventional job in insurance and wanted to start exploring his the performance of his gender, and I think he's working towards identifying as non-binary, but he wanted the shoot to be quite ritualistic, so to have all these different stages, and the makeup artist would transform him at the same time as their clothing. And it was a really great afternoon. So these are the sorts of things that I feel like I've encountered that are that come my way. I wanted to say it. That's me done. Thank you.
Thank you, Grace. Next up is Ekene Ekobi.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me if I stand right here, or if I do this? Before I show that I'm going to show you, I just wanted to talk about answering Dr. Lori's call and what that meant for me in the context of all these amazing artists you're seeing today. So I think there was something in the call out about lens-based practice, but I didn't really pay attention to it. I'm a performing artist for the most part. I definitely do take photographs, but that isn't the mainstay. I'm definitely not a professional photographer. But I did answer, theater performers are kind of hams. And Dr. Lori took months to get back to me, or weeks, and finally she was like, I'm not sure you're art fits into this. Can you explain more? And so I was like, well, I do take photos. I guess I could be. So basically, I talked my way into this. And then I came to this event. I really just wanted to meet other artists in London. And I was like, oh, it's photographers. And the funny thing is, I'm showing my work to other amazing photographers, and they're kind of looking at it like, okay. You know, I'm looking there at their work, which is amazingly beautifully lit, the technical process of it. And I was like, wow, I kind of injected myself into this space. And then I had to produce something after, which as a performing artist, I was paired with Beth, and you'll be seeing her work shortly. I told her that it took me a long time to realize that performing artists are kind of the weirdos of the art world, which means that you are the weirdest of the weird. I remember telling one of my, I teach as well, and I was telling one of my students this, and she looks at me like, you're just figuring that out. 16-year-old child looks at me like, you're out. And I was like, I am. And all of this is to say that I think, though, what I love about performing arts is it dispels this notion of the artist as the individual. Art is a community practice, and I see it as a community practice, and I also see it as a spiritual practice as well. I think when you're working in other art forms, this illusion of the lone artist is easier to maintain, but your practice, even if you're putting up a one-person show, you have to do it in community, and you have to do it in collaboration as well. And so you have a different approach to the way that you deal with things. I decided I didn't want to show any of the work that I had produced previously because I have just recently moved to London to attend school, and I wanted to acknowledge the fact that I've sort of moved to a different place in the work that I'm producing. But that also created a logistical hurdle for me in that I had to find people. As always, if you're putting on a show, if you're doing any kind of collaborative thing, and you're doing it in a lens-based way, meaning that it's not something that's ephemeral that just sort of happens, you have to pull people together in time and space and align them all. And so then that became a logistical hurdle that I almost thought I was not going to accomplish. But performing arts, the show must go on, and in fact, this did. I do a lot of performing arts traditions, but the one that I enjoy the most is something called Theater of the Oppressed. So what you're gonna see right now, Theater of the Oppressed is a political form of theater. It was originated by Augusto Boal, who is a Brazilian educator and theater practitioner as well. He believes that there is an artist in everyone, and that's how his work originates. He doesn't believe in creating a hierarchy of art production. He feels that that is part of a capitalist tradition. Theater of the Oppressed works for me as an educator because when I'm teaching performing arts, I try to get the students that I'm working with, particularly when I was working in the States, not all the students I was working with wanted to be performing artists. So I had to explain to them how working in an artistic tradition would help them in general. And a lot of the times it is about collaboration and it is about working together. Augusto Boal wrote a book called Games for Actors and Non-Actors, which I rely heavily on when I'm teaching. It's basically warm-up games, but they're also games where you can talk about issues of power and oppression. Just through the game, playing the game alone. So he has a game called The President's Bodyguards. That's what you're gonna be watching right now. The people who I managed to pull together to perform this game at various London locations. So I called this video the British Grenadiers Edition. How do I open this? I'm sorry, it's a bit loud. I just want to. Is it? Yeah. Perfect.
Thank you very much, Ekene. Next up, we have Beth Fox.
Hello. I'm not a very good public speaker, so I'm just going to play the work, if that's okay.
I will talk to you of art, for there is nothing else to talk about, for there is nothing else. Life is an obscure hobo bumming a ride on the omnibus of art. Burn gas, buggies, and whip your sour cream of circumstance and hope. And go ahead and sleep your bloody heads off. Creation, all else is not. What is not creation is graham crackers. Let it all crumble to feed the creator. The artist is. All others are not. A canvas is a canvas. A rock is a rock or a statue. A sound, sound. Or is music. A creature is a creature. Or an artist.
Great things.
Gershwin, he's great, isn't he? I usually make such a big deal about picking models, but Carl is so thorough. I bet he drove you nuts checking your resume, huh? This is not a nude.
Just put them on the table.
Does the female form make you uncomfortable, Mr. Lebowski?
Is that what this is a picture of?
In a sense, yes. My art has been commended as being strongly vaginal, which bothers some men. The word itself makes some men uncomfortable. Vagina.
Oh!
Bravo! Bravo!
Mirror, father. Mirror. Mirror, father. Mirror. Mirror, father. Mirror. Mirror, father. Mirror.
Piece is entitled Mirror, Father, Mirror. I like to show it to people that I'm meeting for the first time because I think it says so much about who I am and what it feels like to inhabit my specific skin.
There is a hard, heavy physicality to my new paintings, in part because I've executed them on wood. But I'd say that they're tempered by the... tempered by the ephemeral use of color. I mean, you could almost say that it's beyond natural color. Well, I think they're about seeing and the responsibility that comes with it. Okay. Thanks. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Put your face here.
Great.
What are you doing? You're not going to paint me, are you?
I might put you in one of my paintings. There's one that I want to do of an Icelandic hero. He's a thief. He's made of fire. But you might not like that.
Why not?
Because you're in the movies and... Are you serious?
Yeah, I mean nothing.
I see you with someone else now and I'm fine, I'm civil. What else do you want?
Hey, what are you doing? What are you doing? Are you punishing me?
Punishing you?
It's all right. It has a sense of accident to it, don't you think? I'm really captured, but I feel good about it. I didn't use drugs.
This is excellent. This is really the best one. I mean, to me, you really broke free on this one.
That's an old one.
Yeah, but it's a really good direction that you're heading in. You know, maybe you should try and get back to it.
In 75 years, you're going to be fucking dead. I'm going to be staying next to Picasso and Vincent! So get the fuck out of here! Jackson Pollock, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
What does it say to you?
It restates the negativeness of the universe, the hideous, lonely emptiness of existence, nothingness, the predicament of man forced to live in a barren, godless eternity like a tiny flame in an immense void with nothing but waste, horror and degradation forming a useless, bleak straitjacket in a black, absurd cosmos.
What are you doing Saturday night?
Committing suicide.
What about Friday night?
Right, so now, can I have all four artists join me at the front, please? In your pairings, okay. Okay, so this is the kind of experimental part. So on my left and my right, the artists had matched together, and obviously we've seen quite an interesting selection of work, and perhaps we can already say why and how they've matched. But this part, we're going to kind of leave it to them to have their what did I call it again? These unfinished conversations, yes. Perhaps, right? And then maybe there's some things that you've noticed that either maybe across the board that all of them are looking at. So I'll start off with Akiko and Grace. Quite interesting. How and why actually did you match first off?
I just liked her straight away, even without looking at her work. I just felt... it's not that if I met her. So it sounds weird. I'm weird. So I felt I have a metal somewhere and instant trust. Then when she started showing her well, I thought how interesting because I didn't know she let the people to be who they are. And then I really want to be photo feel terrible, but I thought, I felt it would be very good for me, I felt, to be photographed by her. I personally can relate to her photograph in the one in the Sweden, Lapland, I can't remember that, one in the snow, mm-hmm. And also lady recovering from anorexia. But also, I don't know if I told you, maybe people don't believe from my work, but I do another side of it, which I saw, what I found interesting, Yoma, I can see a few different elements of me, all these people. And a lady from Syria, who likes to be photographed, I do burlesque. So that's a different side. And just a selfish of me, I thought, in front of, maybe by working with you, I thought maybe, I never been good at collaboration, or that, but I thought to be nice. Or you can tell me what to do or something. But I felt instant trust and warmth. That's very, very nice. Sorry.
Thanks, Akiko. That's really nice. I had the same, we didn't really share that much work, I don't think, when we were doing the speed dating event. It was just that, oh, I like you. And I'd like to know more. And there was 8 minutes, which I'm sure you can all imagine was not a very long amount of time to explore the other person and their work. But I think for me, I was just really struck by the depth of the work that you're doing and how poignant and atmospheric it was. And I just had a real, I don't know, there's that click when you get on with somebody, but then there's also a real desire to know more. So even though we've met once since, it's still not long enough, is it? Like, there's still things that are emerging, or pennies that drop when I saw your presentation, or yeah. And just the transition of the work, I really enjoyed.
Thank you. As you can see, our practice is so different, but I certainly come to the way you work with camera, with people. That really interests me. I don't think I never could do that. I'm terrible at making photographs for the people to like it properly, which you can, which is quite a gift, I think. So when people ask me, to, can they take photograph of their wedding or something, I usually say no, because I don't want to lose the friendship.
That's brilliant. I mean, lots of people have asked me to photograph their wedding. I've also said no. But I should probably mention, actually, that one of the things that Akiko brought up when we met recently was... I married myself, and it went into this quite extensively. And there's a little bit of that on my website, which Akiko picked up on. And we had a few conversations about that. And I was sort of thinking, well, no, this is about my photography work, so I'm not going to bring that in. But then Akiko was like, kept talking about it, asking me questions, which took another thread and another line of conversation, I think, which was also quite interesting around... you know, women and society, and we talked about the difference that I feel about being a single woman in the UK, and then you talked about the relationship to women. I can't remember, what was the phrase that you used?
I just feel self-marriage is maybe answer to the life, and it really brought me all sorts of my past, or how I think of my life. And I think because, as it says, self-marriage, you are committed to yourself. Otherwise, I don't think you could take photograph the way you are with people, I think. Because I think you're contained with yourself, and I assume you're very comfortable with yourself, and... otherwise, other person in front of the camera maybe can't feel comfortable. Or, I think.
It's difficult to know.
Also, although I used to marry, I don't know what this marriage about still. But still, I think when I go to wedding, I'm the kind of the typical woman who start to cry or. When I feel the divorce paper, I still felt sad, or I don't want to touch it. So it means something. Eh? But then I feel, I don't think I will do it again. And then, so I still question. And then, but when I saw the program, and how, if any of you don't mind saying that, if you put the TED, the talk, TED.
Oh, the TED.
I think people will be understand how I felt, I thought.
Can I ask, do you both see yourself as photographers? Because I think it's interesting, both of you talk about making work for others. You're making it maybe for the living and people want it, and maybe you're making it for the non-living. So how do you see yourself as photographers, or do you see yourself as vessels or people who are making work for others?
Making for others?
Go on. No, I feel that's a really good question, because... I think there are sort of a spectrum, I think, or a continuum where there's something that I really want to do and I have an idea and I'm going to go and find a way to do it, and then there's things that come to me. So I think I work quite responsively a lot of the time. But there's usually like a dialogue, and it's quite cyclical. It doesn't seem to be just for me or just for that person. There's usually a link somewhere. Mm. Yeah. And that's the easiest way I can explain it.
Sorry, Abby, did you say you thought I'm taking photograph for others?
Yes, you remember at the beginning you said you're making work, but you're making it for yourself.
It's more to this, I feel never been creator of what I shot. In that sense, I feel, I don't know, maybe because I feel not connected with me or my own body. Maybe it's to do with that, but I feel a bit like a half dead, half alive, so that maybe I'm more closer to these people who are dead, or I'm really literally interested in how they're observing us. Maybe, okay, I don't know. So like, for me to be important, maybe tuned to whatever I'm in front of me, and as soon as I've been very self-conscious to take a good photo, all my photos are terrible, unbelievably bad. So maybe that's my limitation as a photographer, but maybe so maybe that's why I can't do collaboration too. It never worked too well. And, so I'm very, maybe not, I'm doing the work for the dead people, not for the people. Yeah. And a very selfish way of saying, but I want to see probably what I want to see. So I'm doing work for my own pleasure. Mm. And if it's lucky, I would say I'm a very selfish artist, really, not to. Or I'm interested in all these documentary films or social, okay. What's going on. But.
Okay. Thank you. Let's move on slightly to my right, to Ekene and Beth. Another very interesting pairing, and I can see why you were paired together. But maybe you can discuss that as well, as in what you found in each other's, whether it was the practice or the person, why you connected.
We had our conversation towards the end of the night.
It's the very last one.
Yeah, and so. Everything had sort of fallen apart because of the fire drill. And so I'd fallen out of the rotation, I think.
Yep.
Yeah, and then we were like, I don't even know if we had an opportunity to really show each other our work.
No, not really.
Yeah.
We spoke for like 2 minutes, and yeah. Then it was like, oh, we should speak again.
Well, yes, because security was like, get out of the building. And... So it's funny that we ended up being paired because we both do a lot of video, and you also do a lot of play space work. So maybe it was that we weren't supposed to look at each other's work until we were paired together.
Yeah, maybe that's how it worked out.
What I found fascinating about what you were doing is it very similar to what I like to do, which is political comedy, which is visual, but maybe a little tongue-in-cheek, not very serious. Or I shouldn't, it's not necessarily that it's lighthearted, but it's maybe not propaganda. And so when I saw some of your work on your site, I was like, okay, that's, I could get with that ethos, you know? But I think when I started describing to you sort of what was in my mind, you were like, oh my God, that seems a little out there.
No, I think I was interested in the fact that you work with actors, because obviously I'm working with appropriative footage, so, I mean, they are actors, but it's like this removal. Also, I hate public speaking and drama and like things like world at all. Mm. So that working with obviously the work that I made is about this archetype that exists, like artist as this mad person alone, and this stereotype and how that representation on screen kind of influences how we kind of choose our profession, because we see this identity which is displayed in popular culture and blah, blah, blah.
And basically, you're saying that this is the first time you're working with live bodies.
That was it, because...
In a space.
In a way, it's a self... it's the same thing. Like, to edit appropriate footage, you are by yourself. You are doing very, like you are a mad loner just in front of your computer. So the idea of working with someone who works in like a collaborative sense with a bunch of people was really attractive. So I think in a way that was something I got from looking at your site, and then it was really exciting to actually be part of the collaboration.
I should also add, I made Beth do the theater games at first, because I think it's important. One of my friends who was in that is a writer. She's a playwright, but she doesn't. She was so uncomfortable. She and Beth were like, "Oh my God, I can't believe we're doing this." And I said, "Nina, you need to know what you're asking your actors to do." And I think that the thing about the work that you do, it is still in collaboration, but the collaboration is attenuated in a way that you're working with work that has been done. So the collaboration can sometimes feel invisible, yeah. You know? And when you were talking about the artists, you know, we have this whole conversation about how art is represented. And I think a lot of times in the public imagination, there's a lot of depoliticization of art. And I think that's why people always color, because artists of color tend to be, for whatever reasons, like we have to bring that, our politics to the fore. Mm-hmm. But all art is political. Even if you're not making a political statement, by not making that statement, you're being political. You're making a statement about where your politics lie. And I said that to you when I watched the piece, like the thing about are the artists in the movies is this sort of crazy person in a garret or whatever, sniffing their turpentine. But I think what really frightens people about artists and why artists are constantly the same way women are, the same way people of color are, portrayed in very dismissive ways is because of the danger, how we call things into question and how we call the status quo into question all the time. And so there's a real need to minimize our effect in popular culture for that reason. And I think that there's ways that the artist captures that, but in very subtle ways.
Thank you.
Can you just say a little bit more about your locations and maybe how power or the establishment even comes into the work that you shot as well?
So I've been thinking a lot about memorials probably for 5 years because I went to a poetry slam. It was a youth poetry slam in New York. And there was a young queer girl who said, "Oh, you're so..." Her poem was beautiful. And part of it said, everybody says you're so brave, but there's not going to be any memorials to me. And in the same time, I also think about the fact that we don't see a lot of memorializing of people who were like peace warriors or people who did like really amazing yet non-martial things in the world. And we say as a culture that we want peace. I don't believe that at all. Absolutely, I don't believe that. But what we memorialize, and as an educator, I see this as well, what we valorize, what we put our lens on, what we focus on, is violence, and violence on a mass scale. And people talk a lot about terrorists and how scary they are and how terrible they are, but really they're just non-governmental actors doing the same thing that Cecil Rhodes or all these people that we erect, we take the work of artists, we put money and resources into directing the attention of artists to erect these monuments. As an artist, I know that I don't want to put my focus on war. I know that I don't want to put my focus on bloodshed, but I think when you look at the history of art, and that is something that I do a lot with my students, is trying to get them to think about who are art's patrons. You know, who's supporting art? Where did art come from? And it really comes back to that whole idea of art being a spiritual practice. Who has the resources to enable art to happen? And so there are memorials everywhere in the UK, and this is a really interesting time politically in the United States and in the UK. And I was really thoughtful about the music, who produced the music that underscored these pieces, right? So now this island wants mm-hmm. to sort of pull up the drawbridge and say, no, you can't come here. Mm-hmm. But even if you look at the history of Europe, life expectancy exploded mm-hmm. after the so-called age of exploration and the subsequent colonial period, which mm-hmm. means that Europe literally got fat off of the wealth, you know? And we don't want to have that conversation, and even in Brexit, we still don't have that conversation about how the developed world runs on just continued plunder of what we call the developing world.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to open it up. I should say as well that even though they are matched, on the actual initial day, a lot of artists match with each other, but it got so complicated. It got so complicated, and there were some artists who just match with everyone because, you know, they could see a connection with everything. So I had to go back to the drawing board and think about a different way. Then they had to do their matches in preferences, hierarchies of preference. So again, they could have matched with each other and maybe seen connections. So I'm going to open it up to everyone else. It would be nice if anyone's seen any observations or anything they want to share with what they've seen and something. There is a mic, should you need it.
I'm another public school. I'm quite interested in this kind of metamorphosis unfurling process that you both were speaking of, and also the kind of deconstructive process you seem to have been addressing, and also this kind of I had a huge affect when you said something about half are dead and half alive, and I just wondered if that was a metaphor, a gendered metaphor as well. Like, if patriarchy is running things, then that means half, the other gendered half has been dead or killed or genocided on some level, whether it's on a psychic level or on a literal level. Yeah, and it's just really healthy, I think, to have a forum that begins to unpack that in very diverse ways. So, appreciate it.
There might be a question or two, but I'll just
or an observation. Should we keep it observation? Anyone else? Observations, questions? Anyone make even work similar? Carl.
So, as a question, actually, I think that part of the connection that you made, obviously, is kind of what happens between people. You know, in what we were talking about at the very beginning of this introduction, the effective nature of things, but also, you know, we kind of live out, in a sense, our competences, if you sort of mean, if you understand what I mean by that. We kind of live out our competences, things that we are good at, if you sort of mean, through our practices sometimes. And it's just the way that I kind of sometimes think about things. Do you think that there is some sort of connective nature of things that you kind of spot in one another because of the competences that you show? It's just interesting that the pairings that you kind of selected and the way that you are with each other, which is important, comes across as somebody who's observing. So I'm really interested in how we show our competences and whether you think that might be something that you bring to the fore. And when you meet people, Do you show your competences as a kind of sense of formative self, let's say?
go first.
I just
Sorry, could you speak about your vulnerabilities as well as competencies?
I think that's part of it, competencies and failures, and vulnerabilities, that'd be part of it.
I would love a clarification on the term competencies, maybe. I could deal with a clarification on.
So a competence, in a sense, is something that you do as a repeated action. Yeah. So we understand the world through activity, let's say, if you coming from a view. And then something we repeat when we repeat operate doing it. We optimize our performance of things as a way of understanding the world. So competence is a way of understanding the world, in a sense, through practice. It's the way that I kind of envisage these things. Practice being something that is like a reconstruction of experience. So you could, from that point of view. So I'm kind of looking at competence from the point of view of, is it, the things that you're good at, but also the things that you're not so good at. But the question is pointed in a sense of, do you think we bring out our competences, the things we are good at, rather than the things that we're less good at? It's a point of view. I'm just interested to hear that point as a point of view.
It's interesting.
I think there's things that I think that I'm good at, right? And then there are things that people assume that I'm good at, and then there's somewhere where they meet in the middle. And that has put me in a situation where I feel like I'm always learning new things because I'm always sort of put into new situations. And that's been a blessing and a curse. But I think